got to watch that film last year during the summertime in the conference that we had up in Indianapolis. And I really, really thought that was a pretty powerful video. Anybody have any idea what that is about? Maddie?
COVID.
It is COVID, exactly. It is all about COVID. It's when for that young girl, Liv McNeil, what she went through. And if you go back to when that happened, because I was here at the school when they said, oh, we're going to take some time off and you're on your own. We're thinking, well, maybe a couple of weeks because it's right before spring break. Did any of you all get anxiety, stressed out, depression when that first happened? Yeah, I did too. Because I had no idea what was going on in your lives. We didn't get to talk to each other. I would send in my lessons to the teacher, and then my teachers would send them to you. I have no idea if you were actually doing them, actually reading them, anything else. But for some people, it's like, yeah, not being able to see people. Going out was kind of like, oh, you didn't know whether you wanted to go out or not. People were staying home. You couldn't find groceries. You couldn't get, you know, toilet paper at the store for some reason. But all these things happened. It's like, yeah, you didn't get to see your friends. And then when you finally did start going out, we all masked up. And it was just weird wearing the mask. And even when we came back to school for that first part, we all had to wear masks. And it's like, am I supposed to talk to somebody? Am I not supposed to talk to somebody? You know, some kids were wearing masks, some kids weren't wearing masks, and it's like, wow. And for that girl, I thought that was ninth grader at the time, I thought that video that she put out won a couple of awards. Was like one of those things is like, yeah, a lot of people felt that exact same way when COVID hit. You've got a lot of anxiety and stress in your lives already. So what I'm going to do, because we talked last year about what anxiety is, words that are associated, all those wonderful things. I'm going to have you break into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. You have a minute to get into four groups of four. Don't get up yet. Don't get up yet. When you get into a group, this is what I want you to do. You are going to share with each other something that causes you anxiety. And then as a group, you are going to decide which one you think has the most anxiety, and you're going to share that with me. And I'll tell you right now, if you say, oh, it's school, which I've had happen a couple times already, you're going to tell me what about school causes you anxiety. If it's a family member, what about them causes you anxiety? You've got 1 minute, go. Talking about what I want you to talk about, so kudos to this class for that. All right, Group number one, do you have yours figured out yet? Are you needing a few more seconds? You ready? Few more seconds, that's fine. How about group two, you got yours figured out yet? They're getting there. Group three, got yours figured out yet? Thirty more seconds. I'll give you all 30 more seconds. Group four, got yours figured out? Yes, nice. Brady back there. Brady back there. Brady over here. All right, group number one. What is most anxiety?
Just like talking in front of people, social events.
Social events, talking to people. I get that. How many of you all like actually doing public speaking? Anybody? That's a good thing to have. It is a great thing. Social events. Is it around new people that you don't like, or just large crowd, large groups of people? Or both? Both. And I get that one of the other classes says meeting new people, Christmas time, going to parties where you don't know anybody and it's kind of awkward sitting there and you don't want to talk to anybody, but you've got to go. Group two.
Grades.
Grades. Yeah. What? This is an easy one. What about grades causes you all anxiety?
I think I was grades one. My dog, whenever she goes out in the woods at night, I can't see her because she's black. She's like really dark.
Oh.
It's hard to see her.
I get that. I have two little bitty Dachshunds that are dark color. And at nighttime, when they go out, and they can't see them. So it's like, are they out there or not? Do they come when you call?
No.
And that makes it worse. But I like the grade part of it too, because right now in middle school, your grades matter, but not as much as next year when you're in high school. Because for some of you all, you will want to go to college, and they are going to look at your grades. What your GPA is. Some schools have higher standards than other ones, but yes, you definitely want to watch your grades. But I get the pet part two. Group number three.
Death.
Oh, it is.
Which one?
Do you like going to the hospital? Does that give you anxiety?
No.
No, it doesn't. Like if you're going in the hospital?
No.
Well, good, but death definitely. Unfortunately, we had one student who had lost a parent. But anytime death comes around, it does cause you the whole thing of going to the funeral home and actually losing somebody. Right now is probably one of the worst times because we got Christmas coming up really quick, and that adds a lot of anxiety, depression, stress into that one also. So I do like that one. Ladies.
Being overwhelmed.
Overwhelmed with what?
School.
Does school overwhelm anybody else in here at times? The homeworks and the assignments and the sports and the activities and boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever else may actually go into that. Does that overwhelm you?
Definitely.
It definitely does. Yes.
Like when I'm out and then I'm not learning.
Oh, yeah. And some of you all this year, if you've had, because some students have had COVID, SRV's going around, pneumonia's going around, not pneumonia,
RSV,
I should remember that, SRV, that's my daughter's Sierra Rain Band, so I get that all mixed up all the time. But yeah, or whether it's the flu, whatever it is going around, you've missed quite a few days. I know teachers give you some time to make it up, but like, you know, that can really be overwhelming. What I want you to do is go back to your seats really, really, really quick for me. Good responses on that. I like that. How many of you have ever watched Cheers before? Anybody watch Cheers? Cheers. Not Cheers. Oh, my goodness. Don't watch Cheers. Actually, it's a good comedy, but it's not Cheers. How many of you watch Friends before? There we go. Friends. Joey's catchphrase up there on the board. How you doing? How you doing? Because he's got that accent with it. So, how are you all doing as eighth graders? Anything going on? Anything bothering you? Anybody nervous about what's coming up next year when you all go to high school? Anybody in here on a sports team? I know you are. Do you get nervous or anxiety when you play sports? You do. I watched a couple of really, really good games this week. The boys playing, two 7th, 8th grade boys and nail biters. Both those games came down to the end. I watched the 6th grade girls. Highland Hills girls are down 18-12 in the 4th quarter, and then they scored 3 straight buckets, and they scored 2 more. Thankfully, they were up 22-18 because one of the girls on Silver Creek's team come down with the time about to expire, and she nailed bottom of the net 3-pointer. That's one of those things that could actually give you anxiety. Anybody in here worried about their grades? And a couple of you all are worried about your grades. How many of you are in band, orchestra, choir, or handbells? Does that give you some type of stress also? It does. Especially if your first chair violin and you've worked to get to that first chair, is there, Lily, your first chair? Yes. Is there pressure on you to hold that spot because you know the person's in second chair wants that spot also? And then when you go to competitions or performances, there is a lot of pressure put on you. How many of y'all have parents who put pressure or anxiety, give you pressure that causes anxiety about either it's your grades or playing sports or the way that you act? Your parents want the best for you. And I'm a parent. I know sometimes I put a little too much pressure on my kids to succeed or excel in something else. Has anybody in here had somebody ask you if you've got a boyfriend or girlfriend? Got a couple of people on there. Is that a little bit of pressure and a little bit embarrassing also? One no, a couple of yeses it is. What? It depends on who it's from. You'll get in high school, yay coming up, where somebody will say, oh, Morgan, have you found somebody yet? Morgan's going to be like, well, no, well, what's wrong? She hasn't found that special someone. And then she's going to find the special someone. What happens when you're in high school and you start dating? Usually when you first get out of high school, then what do they start putting pressure on or asking about?
Marriage,
yes. Oh, you've been dating that person for a couple of years. Is there any talks of getting engaged or any talk of getting married? And then, you know, you get engaged and you get married. And then what's the next pressure put on you after you get married?
Having kids.
That's not a good thing. Mrs. Scott, could you do this one really well?
Sometimes friends, family members, they don't mean anything by it, but maybe that couple's trying and they're having fertility issues. I know several people that have dealt with fertility issues that told us later. Mr. Vance knows couples that have dealt with fertility issues, and that's something that you don't want to broadcast to anybody because, you know, you just kind of keep that private. And you know, we've had family members that nobody knew that they were having fertility issues, and then they didn't tell anybody. Her mom actually bought her, like, baby items for, like, Christmas. Like, things like that, like, trying to hint, we'd love to be grandparents. And they didn't know. Like, so don't ever put pressure on somebody to have kids or, I mean, even to get married. Like, maybe the timing is just not right. Or maybe that couple has been having issues and they don't know, you know, if that relationship is going to last. So those are two things that you don't want to pressure somebody into.
My oldest daughter turns 27 next week. And we get asked all the time about when are we going to have grandbabies. And I'm like, I don't control that. My kids are the ones that control that. They may have grandbabies, and I hope that they do because it's going to be a joy. But if they don't, that's okay also. So don't let somebody pressure you into something like that when you're not ready. Or maybe it's not what you want because not everybody wants to be a parent. Not everybody wants to get married. And some people don't like dating, so don't let people pressure you into doing some of those things. So what you do right now is on the inside of your name tag, open it up, and what I want you to put down is at least four people that you feel comfortable talking to when you've got some anxiety or stress, depression going. Somebody that you can call up and say, hey, Jenna, I need to talk to somebody. Or maybe it is you're going to text somebody. So I'm going to send a text message to Morgan and say, hey, Morgan, here is what is going on. Or maybe it is a phone call. Or maybe actually seeing somebody in person. Sitting down, say, hey, Jackson, here's what I've got going on. You got a minute? Can I talk to you? Who's the four people that you've got that you feel comfortable with that will help you in life's way when things start going bad? At least four. Some people say, can I put more? I'm like, yeah, the more you put on there, the better it off that it is going to be. For some people that say, you know, I can only think of one or two people, hopefully you can think of one or more than one or two people. If you're having a hard time finding somebody, can you put Mr. Vance down on your name tag? Memphis, can you put me down? Somebody you can talk to? I hope so. Or any of your teachers. Or your counselors, or whoever it may be. I've had students that have talked to me before at lunchtime. I've done breaks with students. Stayed after school one time to talk to somebody about some things that are going on. Usually it's just simple things I'm struggling with, or my parents are having problems, or whatever it is. But yeah, you can put that down. I'm not going to ask you to share your list. That's your list personally. But is there anybody in here who would like to share somebody who is on their list? Thank you. Your mom. Usually parents are at the top. Your dad, that's the top ones. Thank you. Who?
Miss Seward.
Hey, teacher. So, yes. Oh, okay. Anybody else on this side got anything? Your best friend. Huh. Thank you, Sarah. Your aunts. A lot of family members come on this, or a lot of people actually put friends down. Mrs. Scott, who's you? I'm going to ask her. I'm going to make her tell me. Mrs. Scott, who's your four?
My husband, my mom, my best friend Lauren, and either anybody from my church group, like our home life group, or my brother.
For me, my wife. We've been married for quite some time, and she is my number one confidant. We talk about things quite a bit. I got three daughters. I kind of loop them into one group because each of the three, I talk about something different. For one of them, I'll say, oh, this is what I'm going to talk to you about, this one, because this is kind of the way that it happens. My mom, not as much as it used to be. My mom's 91 years old, but I still... She lives next door, and we'll talk about each of us. We'll talk to something about something that's going on. She needs somebody to talk to. I'm the one that she talks to. If I need something, and I'd like, you know, Mom, we're going to sit down. We're going to talk. I'm going to tell her about what's going on or how I'm feeling or something like that. My fourth person comes from above, but that's who my fourth person is. So, yeah, having four. Why do you think I want you to have four people on your list? Any ideas? One of those people are not available. That's excellent. It is, yeah. So if I've got down one person, and Jude is the one person that I've got down, and this weekend he's going camping somewhere. They bring in the cabin, and they're going to go camping. But where he goes, they don't have very good Wi-Fi service. The phones don't work very well down there. And I'm like, you know what? I need to talk to somebody. And I dial his number, and he doesn't pick up. So I text him. He can't get text messages either. It's like, wow, I really, really need somebody else. Four people give you all quite a few options. If I was to say that Maddie was one of the people on my list, but the one that's causing me some stress and anxiety right now is Maddie, I may not want to talk to her about that situation. Husband and wives have that problem sometimes. Once you get married, talk to your spouses. whichever way you go, it doesn't matter. But talk to your spouses. Communicate with them. But sometimes it's like, you know what? I get aggravated at my wife, and I need somebody else to talk to. I should be talking to her, but I don't want to see what somebody else says before I say, you know what, Mrs. Scott? My wife did this. It really bugged me. Mrs. Scott might say, why? Why does that bug you? Is that really worth getting mad about? And I'm like, oh, you know what? It's not. So find somebody out there that you can talk to. For some of you all, it could be, if you haven't got enough people, it could be a coach. It could be a preacher. It could be a counselor or a therapist. Mom and dad, aunt and uncle, best friend. There's so many people out there for you to talk to. And I'm honest with you all. If you ever need somebody to talk to or with, I'll be more than glad to talk to you. You got something going on. I've had students before that come up to me and say, Mr. Vance, you got a minute? And I'm like, yeah, I've got a minute. Matter of fact, at lunchtime today, I had one of the students told me something that he wanted to get off his chest. I already knew it, but he wanted to let me know what was going on. I'm like, I'm good. I'm glad that you got somebody to talk to and kind of get it out of your system. So, some things. Common symptoms of anxiety in teenagers. Constant worry. How many of you all worry about everything? Yeah, that's me. I worry about you all today. Why is Mason not here today? Why is Braylon not here today? I worry about, my team. I worry about all the things that are going on in the world, my kids and everything else. And unfortunately, that is one of those things. It doesn't matter if it's general or specific, I am a worrier. Is that good for you, worrying about everything? No, it's not worrying everything. It's not good for you. Avoidance of activities. How many of you all have had some anxiety or maybe a little bit of stress and you're like, you know what, I don't want to be around people? Don't want to go to a birthday party because you don't feel like it's that time. Christmas is one of the worst times for having stress and anxiety. The feelings of tension where you kind of just, get tense in the muscles and everything else. Certain things are going to do that. You sleep too much or you don't sleep enough. That is me. How many of you have gone to bed and you have a hard time getting to sleep because something is bothering you? You finally go to sleep, and you sleep for a couple hours, and you wake up, and it's still on your mind, and you can't go back to sleep again. Yeah, that's a lot of us, isn't it? It's like, yeah, because of that anxiety and that stress that's going on. Change in appetite. Yeah, you eat too much, or you don't eat enough. That binge eating for stress is actually real. I don't think it's like what they show in the movies or the shows where the girl gets out the quart of ice cream and she eats the whole thing. Don't do that because that much ice cream is not good for you. But yeah, we do constantly think, we've got something to take our mind off that. Restlessness, difficulty sleeping, kind of goes to the one back up there. Constant seeking of reassurance. You're feeling down, everything else, you want somebody to validate you because you feel like you're down towards the bottom. Constant headaches. Anybody get headaches when they're stressed out? Stress headaches, yeah. Muscle tensions, where your body just cramps up so much. These bottom three are the ones that bother me the most. The excessive guilt or feelings of worthlessness. How many of you ever blamed yourself for something that was not your fault? Yeah, unfortunately we do that. A lot of times when mom and dad get divorced, and it's sad, I hope it never happens, but for some reason young people want to blame themselves, it's my fault. It's not your fault. There's something else going on, and they couldn't work things out. They didn't want to talk to each other, but it is not your fault. That worthlessness, that hopelessness, nobody cares about it. I've hit rock bottom, and there's no way that I can get up. I've failed so many times. So many people are disappointed. Nobody wants me around. Well, that's not true. I told you this last year, and I'm going to tell you again this year, and I'm going to get you in high school, and I'm going to tell you again, I care about each and every one of you. Even my worst student in the class, I care about that person. I do. Doesn't matter how good you are or how bad you are. You know, when I walk into school, and I think I've told you this before, but when I see my students, it makes me smile. When we walk down the hallways and someone yells out, Mr. Vance, and I'm going to yell right back at you. We walk down the highway, whether we're dabbing each other or we're giving each other high fives or whatever it is, that makes me happy. It makes you happy. Mrs. Scott cares as much about you as what I do. It's like, yes, because you are important to us. Occupation with death or a preoccupation with death or dying. Because when you get down to this point and this point, all of a sudden it's like, you know what? Bottom's falling out. It's not good anymore. And you start thinking about how suicide enters your mind, as well as things that is hard to shake. And it's not a good thing. And if that becomes with you problems, find somebody. Find somebody, talk to somebody before it gets too late. Do's and don'ts. How many of you have a song that you turn up on the radio to make yourselves feel better? A couple of you all do. What's your go-to song, Janet? Is there a specific song that you say, you know what, I'm feeling down, things are going bad. Is there a specific song or a genre that you will turn up or picks you up?
Like what?
Morgan Wallen. Okay. Anybody else got someone they would like to share that you say, oh, this is who I'm going to listen to? Mrs. Scott, who is your go-to song or group?
Classic rock group. Or Queen.
Queen or Journey. This morning on the way in, because every time I do this lesson, I'm trying to find a song that even when it's 30 degrees outside, when I hear the song, I've got to crank it up and put the windows down. I'm going back to the 80s when I do this. I let my long, gorgeous locks kind of flow in the wind while that is going on. And today it was talking about my generation by Who. Anybody know that song? You need to listen to it. Because it's about when I was growing up, it's like parents and the man wanted to control you. It's like, no, quit talking about my generation. Quit Twitter trying to put us down. It's good for anything. But find something. Journaling, writing it down. Go out for a walk. Shoot some hoops. Go for a jog. Go for a swim. Take your dog outside. Play with your dog outside. Something to get your mind off what's going on. Deep breaths definitely really do help. Probably the biggest thing that you can do is actually talk to someone. That's why you got four people on your list, and there's more than just that. Prayer, meditate, do something to release that tension. You know, clench your fist, let it go. Things I do not want you all doing is also up here. We talked about this last year. We're going to talk about it more this year. Drugs, alcohol, and smoking. Do drugs and alcohol solve your problems? No. Does it make it worse? It actually does. Short-term solution to long-term problems. An argument with a student, not argument, at a chat with a student that said, oh yeah, marijuana. I'm like, no, it doesn't. It's a short-term solution to a long-term problem. Do not hurt yourself. Do not hurt somebody else. Running away from home solves nothing other than the fact that you've got nobody now to take care of you anymore, because you're going to run away to Chicago and you're going to wind up trying to find some place to stay, some place to eat, and you're going to end up in probably not a very good situation. Running away from home is not a good thing. Isolation, when you get home, you slam that door, and you don't talk to mom and dad, or your brother, your sister, your boyfriend, or your girlfriend, you don't want to talk to a friend. Every once in a while, a little me time is okay, but if that's constantly what you're doing, it's going to cause you some serious problems. People who have problems with anxiety and depression, it goes back to those things, those thoughts of dying. Sometimes they take the riskiest chances in the world. You only live once. Might as well get it over with. Anybody in here want to die at the age of 14? No. I don't want to die at 55. I definitely wouldn't want to die when I was 14. And then the last one is suicide. More and more, every single year, we have more people committing suicide. Our numbers in 2020 went up, 2021 went up, 2022 went up, because people don't have these coping skills or ways to deal with it. They don't have that person that they can call and say, hey, Emma, I'm feeling down. You got a minute? Can we talk? They don't have that person. They can't text somebody, which takes me to the next one. The Suicide Prevention Lifeline. This is the old one. You can still use that number. Mrs. Scott's got some of these on her desk. Where she doesn't, I will get some of those, yes. Suicide Prevention Lifeline, just somebody to talk to. This one here is a new one, 988. You can text them, you can call them, whatever you want to do. I called them the other day just because I wanted to get some information from them about this, because I want to talk about it, I want to find out what they're going to do. I sat on hold for a good period of time, which kind of disappointed me. But they've got a lot of people right now that are calling in. They've got people right now that are, there's not enough people to cover all the phones. But call them, send them a text. They'll actually talk to you because they're going to talk to you about what is going on. And I'm going to finish that with, because Mrs. Scott's got a friend who actually does this type of work, and she can tell you a little bit more about that than what I can.
One of my church group friends, her mom, has dealt with mental illness for a long time, her whole life, and she was suicidal at the time, and when my friend was younger, and that hotline really helped her, and that's why she still has her mom. So she said, you know, to herself, like, when I get old enough and I'm an adult, then I'm going to volunteer my time, because they helped me, you know, be able to have my mom still. So I'm going to volunteer. So it is a lot of volunteers that answer the phones there. And she said that, actually, she doesn't get paid to do it, it's just a volunteer thing. But like 98-99% of the time, the person is just extremely lonely. They don't have four people that they could write down on their name card. They don't have one single person that they thought that they could reach out to. And I hope that none of you ever feel like that, because even if you don't do well in a teacher's class or you guys kind of clash in terms of personality, we care about every single one of you. So you have a lot of people that you can reach out to. Mr. Vance cares about every single student that he has in class. You have a lot of people here at Highland Hills. You'll have a lot of people at high school that care about you. You know, your families, your friends, they care. So please talk to somebody if you are dealing with it. Don't keep at it. The worst thing a teacher can go through is losing students. And I've been there. And they did not reach out. And I had no idea. And we've talked about suicide. I mean, I teach health. We talked about suicide in class. And how to talk to people, to reach out, to get help, but not to do that. And it's so heartbreaking when life's a gift. And I want you to live it to the fullest, for sure.
Last year, when the girl from Scribner, Ella, committed suicide, I got a text message from the teachers. They could not tell me who it was because it had not been released yet. And then I found out it was. It broke my heart. It did. Because I talked to her in seventh grade already about not doing this and how rough it was. And that first week of school when I went back, it was horrible. Because nobody wanted to talk, the kids were going to counselors and everything else. That's just somebody I missed. And I'm like, okay, is there something that I could have said that may have prevented that? Is there something that I could do? The only thing I can do is tell you not to and tell you why not to, because as middle schoolers or high schoolers or whatever it is, you've got a long life ahead of you. Are bad things going to happen to you all? Yeah, they sure are, all the way through your life. But don't let that bring you down. When that boyfriend or girlfriend's going to break up with you, it's going to be hard, especially your first love. Like, oh my goodness, I can't believe, and it's rough. There's so many other people out there for you today. There's so many things for you actually to be positive about. And the sad thing about it is for most people when they commit suicide, nobody has any idea that they are even thinking about it. Robin Williams, anybody know who Robin Williams is? Couple people. He is Aladdin off of He's the genie off of Aladdin. He was in quite a few movies. He's one of those guys that just seemed like, man, everything about it. He's successful, got money. He's famous, he's funny. He's got a family. He's got all these things going for him. But sometimes we don't see what's going on behind the mask that people wear, and he committed suicide. Unfortunately, I had a cousin of mine that one morning woke up, everything's going well for him, and one morning he woke up and took his own life. He's the guy that you could have called at 2 o'clock in the morning and said, hey, I've got a problem going on. He would have talked to you until things were okay. One of the best things you all can do, this is what I recommend for a lot of people to do, is be kind to each other. Because you never know when something is bothering somebody. You know, they have a smile on their face, but something is going on. A kind word to somebody, a joke, a handshake, a smile, a hug, makes people feel so much better. And it's better than being someone friendly rather than being somebody that's going to bully somebody or going to put them down. Because I want to see each and every one of you all think you're being successful. I want to see one of you all grow up to be a restaurant owner so that when I come into your restaurant, you will give me free food. I want somebody in here, I see somebody in here who's going to be a lawyer. Somebody in here who's going to be a doctor or going to be a nurse. Somebody in here is going to serve the military. Someone might grow up to be a fireman or a policeman. You may end up saying, you know what, I'm going to grow up, I'm going to be a librarian. That's not a very exciting job. Do we need librarians? We do. Someone says, you know what, I've got a friend who's worked for Kroger ever since he's got out of high school. I'm like, man, why would you want to work at Kroger since you've been out of high school? He gets paid a lot of money because he's been there for a long time and they move him up. Maybe you're going to be a mechanic. Maybe, you know what, you're going to be a stay-at-home parent and take care of the kids. I don't know what maybe, Maddie, you're going to marry a millionaire and you're not going to have to work for the rest of your life. Wouldn't that be nice? It would be. That's what I keep looking for, somebody that I can marry that's a millionaire, not to work for the rest of my life. It just hasn't happened yet. What, Jenna? Something's going on in your head. No, I guess that's not helping. But it is. I see big things out of each and every one of you. With that being said, any questions? Before I turn this back over to Mrs. Scott, and we have our draw. Nope. All right.
Letters. If you don't have it today, bring it on Monday. All right, your envelope